First of all, I'd like to thank Brian for the opportunity to talk about the validation efforts we are doing at WWPDB. So what I'm going to do is I'll give a brief, just one slide on PDBE and a few slides on WWPDB, and then go on to explain the deposition annotation project and the validation reports that we are producing. So just a slide on PDBE. We are one of the founding members of WWPDB and Electron Microscopy Data Bank. The major activities are to accept depositions and annotate them for X-ray, NMR, and EM structures, both the atomic coordinate data as well as the electron microscopy volume data. And since we are at EBI with all the other databases on site, we work quite a lot with them in terms of integrating information from different data resources. And we have, we liaise with the structural biology community in general to get their advice and improve our policies. And of course, we are guided by many different advisory bodies. In terms of WWPDB, it's as John mentioned, there are four partners in WWPDB. The main goal is to manage the PDB archive and then serve it to the user community. So what do we do in the WWPDB partnership? We collaborate on the data in issues. So it's to do with policies on deposition, what we accept, what should be mandatory, etc. We try and work on the weekly releases, so all the sites release the PDB and EMDB information every week, develop validation standards, format specifications. John mentioned the chemical component dictionaries, so all the sites participate in maintaining that, develop new deposition and annotation processes, and in general work on improving the quality of data and integrity of data in the archive, and journal interactions, community interactions. So everything to do with data in accepting deposition, we work very closely with each other, and we have a friendly competition on the data outside, which also serves as a funding opportunity for different sites, as well as the skill sets are different, so it's complementary mostly. So there are two major WWPDB projects where all the four partners have come together and we are collaborating. One is the development of the new joint deposition and annotation system, and the other is on the validation. So on the deposition and annotation side, the system will handle all the X-ray, NMR, EM, atomic coordinate, as well as volume data deposition, and it will be used by WWPDB sites. So all the sites will have the same system. At the moment, we have two different systems for coordinate deposition. There is a third system for depositing electron microscopy data, and another system if you have NMR experimental data. So all this will be replaced by the new system. On the validation side, there are, John mentioned all the different validation task forces that were established by the WWPDB, and as you all might know that X-ray Validation Task Force has given its recommendation. They were published some time ago now. There is a similar effort on the NMR and EM side, and we are now developing the pipelines based on all these recommendations we got at PDBE, and they will get integrated into the new deposition annotation system. So as I said, the idea is once the new system is in place, there will be one common deposition interface, and if you want to deposit both coordinate data or electron microscopy data, the same interface will accept both these data. It will be shared by all the partners, and then we internally will take care of where the depositions go and how it is processed. So in terms of changes for depositor, you will see just one interface, and as I said, we will then take care of where the annotation happens, and we will issue the PDB or EMDB or BMRB identifiers as required. The access to deposition will be through login. All the communication to do with deposition and annotation will be done through the same interface, so we will get rid of sending lots of data through emails. You will have access to all the previous depositions, so you can base your depositions, new depositions, on previous depositions. And as I said, there will be a replacement to emails. It will also add a very important facility of validating the model based on the new validation pipelines. We will try and add value-added information like quaternary structure, which the depositors would get before submission, and there will be additional checks on data integrity before the submission is complete. So what are the advantages of validating all these structures at WWPDB? At the moment, there are many different servers that people use, many different programs that people use to validate the structures, and the idea is to bring this together and put it at the time of deposition so that it basically improves the quality of and consistency of data in the PDB archive. It would also support editors and referees, because we'll give out the validation reports and that could be submitted to journals. And there was a point made in the morning about helping users to find a proper PDB entry to use in their research, and we hope that the new validation information will help users to assess the quality of entries in the PDB and then use the appropriate entry for their use. You can then compare different related entries, because we'll validate all the entries in the archive and make that data available, so that comparing different entries will be easy. It would be possible to identify outliers and then try and find out the reasons behind it, and hopefully all that will improve the overall structure quality and the protocols that community is using. So if we go to what kind of errors we find in the structures, fraud was mentioned, but there are many other errors that do affect users depending on what they are doing. So there could be completely wrong structures, and there are examples of that. There could be register errors, or there could be errors in part of the structures that you are using. For example, incorrectly built loops or wrong residues built in the structure, or there could be bad geometry or stereochemistry, especially in ligands, or incorrect positioning of ligands, or it was also mentioned that people sometimes see things that are not there and they build them, and that has happened as well. So a lot of things can go wrong with ligands especially, and at the moment, because we don't have good validation for ligands when people submit to PDB, a lot of entries and a lot of ligands get through without this validation of geometry, or really seeing if they are present in the electron density. So people build wrong ligands. That has been highlighted in some cases. And there are also cases that were highlighted where there wasn't the density to support the ligand that was built, or they don't know that there is a ligand or there is a bound molecule, and instead waters are put into that place. And as I mentioned, incorrectly or building ligands or the conformation of ligand might be wrong, and many times the stereochemistry is wrong as well. And all this leads to then people using these ligands in their analysis to do ligand design or inhibitor design, and that could lead to wrong ligands being designed. So this is the analysis that was done by CCDC based on Relibes and Mogul. This was their in-house analysis. Now it's published. And they think that with their generous criteria, still 16% of the ligands might be wrong in the PDB. And 29% are borderline. But it's not all that bad because it's an improvement on the previous data that they have from pre-2000. So we are going in the right direction, and what we would really like to do is to move it in the direction where this goes down quite a lot, and hopefully this figure improves. So that's why we are developing the validation pipeline. As I said, the validation task force report was published in 2011, and in the first version of the validation pipeline, what we have tried to do is to include all the tools that would validate the geometry of the molecule, the geometry of ligand, and the data as well. We analyze data using X-Triage and also check the validity of the model against the data using EDS. One of the things that the validation task force has done very nicely is to consider the requirements of users, and especially users who may not be as clued in on crystallography part. And what they have suggested is we create a graph like this, which shows percentile of the given structure with respect to the whole archive, as well as with respect to the structures that are comparable in terms of resolution. And then it doesn't matter what these criteria are. As a user, you are interested in finding out a structure that is in blue region rather than in the red region. So that's the idea, to use these percentile scores to help naive users to find quality of structure. And I'll go through a bit more on what the report contains as well in the next few slides. So in the version one, as I said, it's essentially ready for production use. We are sending out reports to depositors. If you deposit a structure with PDB now, you will get this new style report and you can comment on it so we can improve it before it goes into final production. There will also be a standalone server from next month, and you will be able to upload your coordinates and check and get the validation report back. After version one, we will look into integrating few other validation tools into the pipeline and really try and improve the validation of ligands. And I'll come back to this point later in my talk. So the next few slides show you the validation report, and if people are interested, I have validation reports here printed out for three different PDB ID codes, and you can have a look at the validation reports. So what we are trying to do here is to give a summary information in the first few pages so that referees can look at it and see if the quality of structure is good or bad. And this doesn't require, we are hoping it won't require any knowledge of crystallography, because more and more papers now go into journals with function and all biochemical information, and many times referees are not expert crystallographers. So the first page is general information about the deposition and also all the versions of the softwares that are used to calculate this validation report. The second page summarizes the quality of the structure with respect to the whole PDB, as well as comparable structure in terms of resolution. So this is the percentile plot that I showed before. It shows how many entries were used to calculate the percentile. It also gives you an overview of residue-based quality for every polymer. So there is a color coding here, green, yellow, and red, and that shows the number of residues or percentage of residues that have geometric outliers. Green means there are no geometric outliers. Yellow means there is one, orange is two, and red is three. On top of this line here, for example, you see a red line. What that means is that many percent of residues have issue with RSR. So there is a density problem there. It also shows ligands if they have problems in terms of geometry or electron density. That's the website where you can see a few validation reports as example reports as well as help documentation. The second page just gives what is in the entry, the polymers, what polymers are they, ligands and the image of the ligand and any other small molecules. The next section tries to show residue level plot for each residue. It tries to show if there are any issues to do with geometry or electron density. So you can see this is the plot same as on the first page, but here now this is expanded further to show exactly which residues have these problems. So again, the same color coding, green means everything is fine. Yellow is one problem with some geometry related criteria. Orange is two, red is three, and the dots here now show problem with electron density. So this is dots when the RSRZ is greater than two, as calculated by EDS. There is also a validation of the experimental data using X-triage, and all the information is presented in a table. Then there is a list of outliers. So this is about model quality, bond lengths, angles, torsion angles, clashes. This section is provides this information separately for standard residues or non-standard residues, ligands, carbohydrates, DNA, RNA, etc. And we show five top outliers in each section, and the rest is available separately. So in terms of validating the ligands, we are now using Mogul from CCDC, which allows us to give the geometric validation of ligands, similar to what you saw in the graphs before I showed you. So this shows the RMSZ. So this is the ligand RMSZ for each of these ligands, and also lists all the outliers in table. We are also working with CCDC to get coordinates for all the existing compounds in PDB that are available in CST. So we hope that would also help people get better ligand geometries in their refinements. In terms of validating the model and data fit, there is a section which shows the RSR and RSRZ for proteins, DNA, and RNA, and this is standard as calculated by EDS, it also shows the percentile in those tables. Now, for ligands, it is slightly more difficult to calculate RSRZ because there is not enough statistics available. So what we have done for now is to devise a new score called LLDF. So we compare here the density of ligand with the density of the surrounding residues. The expectation is that if the ligand is present and the surrounding site is good, then the ligand RSR should match the RSR of the surrounding residues. Now it's not perfect, and we are still working on it to see how we can improve this, but this at least gives some indication of the quality of ligand density compared to the quality of the site that it binds in. So what are the long-term plans? We, as I said, for X-ray, we have already started sending out reports from 1st August. There will be a standalone server in September, and it will be integrated with the new DNA system, and we will improve and add new checks to the pipeline. On the NMR side, the VTF recommendations will develop over time, but they have said that we could use the same geometric checks for the NMR models with some additional criteria, and that's being developed at the moment at PDBE. On the EM side, there are similar efforts going on, and there will be some geometric checks, sanity checks made on those depositions. But what I wanted to point out is that this also presents new challenges in terms of how we make this data available to users, because this data is not static. For example, when we calculate the RSRZ for ligand, I said we have developed new method and it will improve over time, which means the values for RSRZ that we provide for ligands will also change over time. With more and more hybrid experiments, again, there will be new methods developed to handle those, and so the validation values for those entries will change. But now that we are presenting these percentiles, there is also issue of changing these values over time. So this is just an example I've given of tryptophan between resolution of 2.4 and 2.6 angstrom. If you see this tryptophan, it was with acceptable RSRZ in 2008, but now that we have many more observations, it's on the borderline. So over time, hopefully, the older structures will get into the red percentile area here, and as methods improve, the newer structures will be better refined and we will have better models. But what I wanted to highlight is this is not just for validation information. This is true for many other data that we provide at the moment in the archive. For example, all the cross-reference information changes over time. All the databases change over time, and that means we have to change all the information that we cross-reference to. And this is a big challenge, and it's not easy. So for last almost 10 years, we have been working with UniProt to tackle this, and we have a resource at PDBE called SIFTS, which is linking basically structure information to all these different databases, and we make this data available weekly and update this data as all these different databases change. So I have just two more slides. One is what else might change. John presented the biologically interesting molecules. We remediated that, and which means the representation of those molecules in the archive has changed. So over time, information changes because the data representation might evolve, or we may have better understanding, better representation for information. And as I said, we remediate data in the archive to make it better, hopefully. And that means, again, the archive is not constant. It is not static. It's changing over time. So I'd like to finish with that and acknowledgements. So PDBE staff, all the WWPDB EM data bank members, all the other collaborators, especially the VTF members and software developers who have given us their software for the validation pipeline, and all our funders. So this is PDBE and all its funders, and there is a big team behind the DNA project and the validation pipelines. So thanks to them as well. Thank you.